Okay, so now we should think about managing technology and innovation and how we take the technologies and work them through to deployable products, systems and services. I find useful the continuum that was defined by NASA maybe about 30 years ago, and it's quite useful. And it's now become an industry standard of reference to what we call technology readiness levels. So these are called TRLs. So TRL 1 through 9. TRL 1, in a sort of a fanciful way, is the eureka moment when we're sitting in the bath and we come up with the perpetual motion machine, or we might come up with a great new idea for a new engine design, or we come up with a great new idea for a new electronic component. Universities tend to work at the TRL 1 through to 3 level. So we come up with a new concept, we take it through proof of concept at the laboratory scale, we do the basic research, we test our ideas in conferencing and journals, we have lots of arguments with each other about what's the right route to take. But round about TRL 3, Technology Readiness Level 3, we've sort of proven that what has been proposed is sensible. It doesn't mean to say it's going to be exploitable, but what it does mean is we've probably got technology that's come through the first few stages. Industry tend to want TRL round about 6, where it's been proven, risk's been driven out of the technical innovation, and they want to take it from TRL 6 through to TRL 9, where it's a product, it's a system, it's a real device, you have distribution systems, you're selling it, you're supporting it, you're evolving it. And there's a bridge then that has to be built between TRL 3-4 and TRL 6. And that's an absolutely key area where business models are essential, investment models are critical, and where we start to build partnerships between the innovators in universities, i.e. the academics, professors, the research assistants, the PhD students, and the industry innovators. Of course, the public sector in some way has a big part to play in that, because they have to de-risk some of the technology innovation by funding the basic research in the first place in order to get it to TRL 3, so the industry can then come and make the typically few orders of magnitude increase in investment to get it to a product. I use the term triple helix to describe that type of relationship, where we combine the strands of the academic community with the public sector supporters. You know, in Scotland, that happens to be Scottish Enterprise, and the rest of the UK, that's called the Technology Strategy Board. But every other country, whether it's America, Germany, France, Japan, they have the equivalent of these public sector economic development agencies. But the third strand is critically important, and that's business and industry. And there has to be a mutual respect across those three communities. We all do different things in different ways. But if we're going to accelerate the deployment of the technology, you need that clear recognition of that spectrum of TRL 1 to TRL 9, and recognizing that the commercialization and the de-risking and the testing and demonstration and deployment of these technologies are where the magic connection is between academic proposition and industrial requirement really sits. In this university, we've been making transformational investments over the past 2 or 3 years. We have a £103 million investment going on as we speak, called the Technology and Innovation Centre, where we'll have 1,200 researchers in a very large research and innovation space in our extended campus, and around 500 industry innovators working alongside our world-class researchers to make sure that TRL 3 to 6 gap is bridged, where industry requirement, very importantly industry understanding, affects the research programs in terms of posing new questions, but the researchers and the more sophisticated companies recognize that one of the biggest values they get from universities is access to independent thinking, where we challenge the norm, we come up with new paradigms, we say, here's a disruptive technology that might threaten their existing products, but could give them a step change in competitive advantage. And of course, the other thing that we give them that they can't produce is world-class graduates, people who have experienced the Strathclyde Business School education, someone that's come out of the engineering school, humanities and social sciences, or science, the science faculty itself. So they get access to intellect, human capital, innovation, and independent thinking. So You know, you look at the product cycles in aero engines. They are over a decade, arguably sometimes two decades, where Rolls-Royce, GE, Pratt & Whitney conceive of the next generation of airframes that typically has with it a requirement for regulatory compliance and low carbon emissions, much lighter airframes, much higher payload, much bigger passenger lists to make the economics work, but none of that will be delivered without technological innovation. But if you tie into that the fundamental need for safety, criticality, low carbon operations, and something that's fit for the aerospace industry and the civil aviation, massive challenges. And to go from one engine to the next takes a lot of very detailed technical innovation, be that advanced materials, you know, new materials for airframes, making the power production on the aircraft, for example, more electric. There are programs across Europe called More Electric Aircraft or Power Optimized Aircraft. It takes not only the burning of air, you know, kerosene air fuels, but also distributing power electrically. So without turning this into a technical lecture, you know, typically the control surfaces, you know, the wing surfaces that allow planes to control their attitudes and their movements and on the tail wing as well, will be driven by hydraulics, which sometimes can bring some risks and technical dependencies problems. Now we're talking about distributing power around the airframe using electrical technologies, you know, using fuel cells, advanced machines, you know, using advanced control technologies. So the cross-technology opportunities that aero industry is now innovating around more electric aircraft, and that's influencing how electric propulsion is going on to ships. So there are ships now that are emerging that are entirely powered by electrical drives. So they're moving away in the marine industry from what is, again, romantically referred to as the tyranny of the shaft line. So marine engineers design the ship, typically over the centuries, around the shaft that's driving the propeller. Now, we don't need that big propeller. What we need are gas turbines producing electricity that then distribute the power electrically onto podded drives, large external to the hull electrical machines, maybe 50 MVA, that's 50 million volt amps of power that give greater maneuverability, etc. But if we were doing this maybe in the 1980s, it may have maybe taken us 10 years to get these podded drives developed and deployed. Now, because of the technological thrust and the business advantage that brings, the testing, the translation of research into product needs to be compressed down to a few years in order to allow the marine industries, in the case that I've just given you, to get that advantage, get more market, use technology to drive their competitive position. So acceleration of technology deployment is fundamental. Back to this partnership activity, we cannot ignore the fact that we are facing some serious global economic challenges, which means, for example, that no one nation has necessarily got all the funding that they require to drive certain industries forward. There's going to be an increasing reliance, which some might argue is a challenge, but others might argue is an opportunity for greater international collaboration to address global challenges, whether that's drug discovery, drug manufacturing and drug distribution, whether it's the next generation of, you know, low carbon power. We've talked about wind, we've talked about wave and tidal, whether it's new manufacturing technologies, automation, robotics, computational intelligence. Arguably, and we can see it in, you know, the major nation states like North America, although Europe's not without its challenges just now, the collaborations that can go on cross European boundaries are very important. And of course, last but not least, and whilst it might be challenging for some, the Chinese capability in their universities, in their emerging industries, India and their major ambitions means that I think the global problems should be addressed by global communities. The investments should be raised by global partnerships. People will always be looking for the best return on investment, and they will also be looking for particular niche opportunities that give them an advantage over another. But in major technologies, this can make a difference. And when we see recent flotations around Facebook, for example, we can see the value, the perceived value that sometimes turns into the reality or otherwise of a share price. We can see the billions of dollars of value that's assigned to things like the social network, media companies. But I think I would be very confident in saying that the social value, the economic value, and the shareholder value in low carbon industries, in health technologies companies, in pharma companies, are also, I think, going to be a very important part of global industry futures. And business models, how these are deployed, innovations around investment, innovations around risk assessment, de-risking investments, and last but not least, the production of very highly flexible, very highly intelligent graduates will be the difference for countries like Scotland, and it will certainly be the difference for those industries that want to compete in a technological age.